qualities, you could say it's pure. You could say it's just. Just means right. And God is not fair. He is just. We think about fairness, and that's not a godly philosophy. We want things to be equal. So the dad, we'll just use Brother Nathan as an example. And the son, we'll use Brother Christopher as an example, are cutting a piece of pie. And the son says, I need the bigger piece because I'm little, I need to grow. And the dad says, I'm bigger, so I need a bigger piece, and you're littler, so you need a little piece. And so the son says, that's not fair because I need the bigger piece. And the dad says, if you eat that big piece, you're going to be jumping off the wall. And so everybody has their take on fairness. If you shoot an owl or you kill a whale, it could be 6 months in jail and $5,000 fine. If you abort a baby, it's legal. Now they're saying you can kill a baby after it's born if you decided you didn't want it, and the mother has the right to make that choice. I'm saying that ain't fair and that ain't right either. That's not just. God is just. So when you're trusting in God, you're accepting God for what he is. And he says, I'm the author of what's right and wrong. And none of you are right. None of you deserve anything. So I'm just. The only other element that could be in the picture is not fairness, because it's not fair that you should not go to Calvary instead of him. If you want to go fair, you're coming up short. Because he didn't deserve to die, we did. The song says, and it's right, I should have been crucified, I should have suffered and died. But he took my place. So fairness wouldn't be good there because we would not. So just comes along with mercy. There's nothing you could do to be just. And so all you can do is plead for mercy. In the American court system, outside the courthouse is a lady holding up a scale, and she has a blindfold on. It means that she is not going to make a judgment on anything else but the scales and the balance. And it's basically saying whatever's right. In our court system, now I know that it's perverted sometimes, and I know that with humanity in the picture, it doesn't always turn out just and right. But it's supposed to, because it's based on the Bible. So when they have you swear in, they use that word, they're having you make a promise to tell the truth. There's only one of those. The whole truth and nothing but the truth. So help you God. That's a pretty big statement. So fairness is not a Bible philosophy. Fairness is a carnal, humanistic philosophy. God is just, and that means he's right and we're wrong, so all we can get is mercy. Thank God he's merciful. In the Old Testament, there was an ark, and the lid of the ark had two angels, and that lid was called the mercy seat. And interesting stories from the Jewish tradition, stories that they tell. But pretty much nobody in the Old Testament had the right to execute judgment. That mercy seat set on top, because that's God. And if God gets a chance, he's going to have mercy. Everybody said amen. So just is right. Scripture talks about we are sanctified, we are justified. That is the root of that word, is just. God has helped us to be right. And then the other word is righteousness. Right. Righteousness means to be right in the sight of God. So I skipped honest on purpose, and I'm going to come back to it in a minute, but the next one is pure. So let's talk about pure. The truth is pure. And if you were totally honest, the honesty part would be pure. I mean, you could be confessing that you're a murderer, but that wouldn't be pure. But honesty, pure honesty is, we're going to talk about that in a minute. But right now we want to talk about pure, because pure is interesting. Pure doesn't happen accidentally. In anything that you're doing, it needs to be pure if it's going to be digested or if it's going to be lasting. And the Bible uses the likeness or the example of gold tried in the fire. Fire purifies gold. How that works is they get it so hot that it boils. And gold is amazing property. And so all of the chaff comes to the top. All of the impurities come to the top. It's a process that has to be done several times. By the fire, then they scrape that top off. And I'm sure you could be standing in line to get the scrapings because there's gold in those scrapings. But no, they're going to reburn that too. But eventually, all of that stuff gets burned out. What you have in the end is pure gold. Pure gold. If you were mining for gold, you would be getting rocks and other things in there and sometimes not even really realize that you have gold. Once in a while, you'll catch a glimpse because gold is in itself, by itself, is pure, so it's going to shine. It doesn't tarnish. I was just in West Virginia, the Charleston capital of the state, has a dome, and it's gold. And so it doesn't get dull, it doesn't tarnish, just stays shining. The weather doesn't hurt it. Gold, when it's pure, is amazing. So the Bible talks about us being tried like gold in the fire so that we can be pure. I'm scared of the subject tonight because it doesn't leave any room for anything but holy. He said, we're going to read the scripture here in a minute, but he said, be ye holy as I am holy. There's no other way to do that except by the Holy Ghost, and I have to continually yield to the Holy Ghost to be holy. So back to pure. The Bible says the trial of our faith worketh patience, and patience worketh in our life, and by the time it's over, we are like gold tried in the fire. And if you've been serving God for a while, you've been through a few trials, you've decided to stick with serving God, you've been through times when you felt like quitting and times when it didn't look good and times when you just got carnal and weren't interested, and you made it through all of that and the trials and the tests polished you and burnt out all of the impurities, and we come out as gold tried in the fire. We come out so good in God that God is proud. Nobody wants to volunteer for these trials, right? But all of us have been through them, and if you haven't been through them, don't raise your hand, because it's coming. God's grace is sufficient, and you can make it through. It's all about what you decide. You make a decision, no matter what. My theme throughout my pastorate here is whatever it takes. Whatever it takes. If there's not enough money to pay the bills, then we pay them with the tithes. That's a no-no by ministerial ethics and ministerial instructions. You don't do that, but I do whatever it takes. Because God keeps good records. You can't outgive God. And so, whatever it takes. If we need work around here, if the toilet needs fixed, if the grass needs cut, if a wall needs built, if something needs to be torn down, if there needs to be some count, whatever it takes. There's really no such time when you say, okay, I'm done, not going any further, that was not a good decision. Don't ever say that. The attitude of profane was referred to in Hebrews and also in Genesis when Jacob and Esau were there, and Esau was profane. And basically what that means is, I don't care. I don't care. That's not a good spirit when you're talking about God. God's looking for an attitude that says, whatever it takes. That's a holy attitude. It comes from the Holy Ghost. I can't take credit for it. But by the grace of God, there's no plan in God's plan that says, okay, it's time to quit. It's time to quit serving God. We don't quit serving God. We get tried by faith. We get tried by trials. We get burnt in the fire. Corinthians chapter 3 talks about the judgment seat of Christ, and there's going to be gold, silver, precious stone, wood, hay, and stubble, and all of it gets tried by the fire. And whatever lasts, that's your reward. Whatever gets burned up is not going to last. And wood, hay, and stubble is pretty much everything you can see here and everything that we have. And if that's all you have in life, then your reward's going to be burned up. But if there's some gold tried in the fire, if there's some strength and stability, if there's decisions made not on selfishness but based on the Bible and Bible principles, then you're going to have a reward. And the Bible says, be not weary in well-doing, for in due season you shall reap if you faint not. So we got to stick with it. We got to make it. Pure. Think about pure. 1 teaspoon of sand in the cake is not going to fly, right? How about a half a teaspoon? How about a pinch? A pinch of salt and a pinch of sand. No such thing, right? No. Pure means pure. Pure means undefiled. Pure means it's over our head. We can't do this. It's going to take the Holy Ghost to do this. Everybody say pure. We're passing by lovely because that's through God's eyes. What we end up being in the Holy Ghost is very lovely in His sight. Amen. Hebrews 11 says, all of these received a good report through faith, but they received not the promise. God have some better thing for us, that they without us might not be made perfect. All of those people from the very beginning all the way down, it has an awesome list, 40 verses. And it talks about what they did by faith. They did it with good intentions. They did it with all their heart. They did it and made it through. They died with a good report. What he's saying is faith alone is not enough. You're going to have God. And so God has a plan, and thank God we're in His plan. So a good report is important. But now we're jumping back to honest, because that's in there too. Everybody say honest. Revelation chapter 21, starting with verse number 8. I don't know if you can say this with me or not, but I'm going to ask you to say it. I am not honest. That's what I thought. You can't say it. Be honest for one time and just say it. Because not saying is not honest. We, in our humanity, are not honest. We're talking about everything we just said. We're talking about truth. We're talking about pure. We're talking about holy. We are not those things on our own. And that's all of the attributes of being honest. Impossible to be totally honest on our own. We need God. We need God. Even with God, sometimes we slip up. And so Paul said, I have to fight this every day. I fight my body and bring it into subjection every day. And I'm thinking, what is he fighting? What is the problem? Well, just look in the mirror. Because he was human just like you. And whatever it is that's bothering you was probably bothering him. And he's basically saying, this is an ongoing battle. I don't have the power to do this on my own. Thank God. Romans chapter 6 or 7 or 8. There is now, therefore, no condemnation to them that walk upright, walk in the Spirit. Thank God that we can do it by his grace, but we can't do it on our own. So the fearful, turn off your phone, please. The fearful. I'm amazed. This is Revelation chapter 21. This is the people that are lost, okay? The top of the list is not what you might think. It's the fearful. Because if you're not holy and you're not pure and you're not true and you're not honest, then you're afraid. Right? If you're holy and you're pure and you're honest and you're just and you're right and you're true, then you're not afraid. Daniel said, sorry guys, but I pray three times a day. I'm not afraid. The three Hebrew children said, we're not even worried how we answer you. That was kind of bold. Because we fear our God more than your statue, and we're not going to bend, we're not going to bow, and we'll find out if we're going to burn. If our God wants us to burn, we'll burn and go with him. This is what they said, paraphrasing, but if he wants to save us, he will. But our trust and our fear is in God. We're not afraid of you. Because obviously they must have been just and true and honest and right. And so they weren't afraid. It's a sin to be afraid like this when sin lieth at the door. Achan was scared to death. And so they said, okay, we don't know who caused this big damage, but we are a very powerful nation winning all battles because God's on our side. We just lost a little battle on the side and 14,000 guys got killed, and it's not right. Somebody did something wrong. We got to find out who it is. Nobody was going to confess, so they said, okay, we can tell. You're going to come before the priest in a big giant line. Think about it. I mean, it's the biggest line almost as the Day of Judgment. Several million people get to walk by the line. We want to see you praise God. Achan came by and he was scared. He knew he was in trouble. There's no such thing as him praising God and singing, and he's got sin underneath his tent floor. So sin is at the door when you're afraid. So at the top of the list is fearful. You can't be afraid. If you're confident in God, if you're doing everything, you're right. If you're, what's the word? Cooperating. You can't be holy on your own. You can't be just on your own. You can't be right on your own. You can't be true on your own. You can't be honest on your own. But by the grace of God, if we lean on the Lord, we don't have anything to be afraid of. He said, fear not. Unbelieving, just filled with doubt and having a problem even buying the story. And that's not acceptable to God. And the abominable, and the murderers, and the whoremongers, and sorcerers, and idolaters. And here's the part we're talking about tonight, all liars. Now, lies are set up in colors. And, you know, when anybody says it's clear, it's like black and white. When anybody says there's a white lie and a black lie, where's the line drawn and what is it about? It's not that big of a deal or it's a big deal. The Bible said, all liars. We just got done saying a while ago that we're not all honest. Some of you were so dishonest you couldn't even say it. You didn't have the heart to say, oh, wait a minute, I'm honest. I'm keeping you awake now. Nobody raised their hand and said, oh, wait a minute, I'm honest. So I wanted everybody to say, I'm not honest, and a few people were afraid. A bunch of people were quiet, and some people muttered something, but I couldn't quite hear what it was. Maybe that was called backbiting. They didn't like the question. All liars. That hits me right in the heart. I mean, I feel like I'm an honest person. I've figured it in life by now. I've been around. So if somebody says, what time will you be back? I don't give them a time if I'm not sure. I will say I'm planning on it, or, you know, other people say the Lord willing. But, you know, don't, especially to your wife or your husband, don't be saying, I will be here at 3 o'clock. You better be there at 2:55 but, you know. So I've found out that rather to just plead the fifth or just don't make a commitment, you know, don't leave a dishonest intention or impression. And we have problems with this. All of us have problems with this. I fight hard not to be dishonest. I want to be honest. I'm going to sell a car. I'm not going to sell the car without telling them what's wrong with the car. Most people are selling their car, and you get down the road and you find out, man, they're nowhere to be found. I want to be honest. And if they can buy it that way, then fine. But I don't want somebody coming back to me and say, you cheated me, or you weren't honest, you misrepresented. It money is not worth that much. How many are with me? Because I got to make it to heaven, and I need to be holy, and I need to be right, I need to be just, I need to be true, and I need to be honest. And I can't do this on my own, so I need to cooperate with the Holy Ghost. How many are with me? So we're winding down here, but the biggest punch is coming. I got to be honest. All liars are going to have their part in the lake which burneth with fire and brimstone, which is the second death. That means to be separated from God. Now, some people have been in this church for many years, so all of this is elementary. They haven't heard anything new, but it's always good. We need to be reminded of what we've said tonight. But there's a lot of new people here, and there's people that need to hear this, and I need to hear it, because I want to be honest. I need to be honest. And to be honest, that's somebody say, well, to be honest. So what does that mean? It means I lie most of the time, but right now I'm going to tell you the truth. To be honest, we are not all that honest. The Bible says the heart of man is deceitfully wicked and he doesn't even know. So don't get too proud and lifted up like, you know what, I'm really doing good as far as, you know, I'm really in there. Well, we're all supposed to be trying to be in there, but this comes from God. God will give you grace. God will give you grace. When you're having your taxes done, and you could save some money if you just tell them something. Remember, there's a IRS, you know, when words are really bad, they just say the letter of the word instead of saying the whole word. People don't even know what the IRS is, but they know that's a bad bunch of people coming after you. So be honest. It pays to be honest. And you know that people around us that are not honest, everybody kind of knows it, And it's kind of embarrassing. I'm embarrassed when I see people being dishonest. And I'm thinking other people know that, and they know that, and I know that, and they're trying to put forth something that's not true. It's like, well, you need to get a reality check. You're not telling the truth. Now, we excuse the little kid with cookie crumbs on his mouth. Did you get in the cookie jar? No. Cookies all over. The evidence is there. I've been in school, and somebody threw a pen or a paper wad across the room, and I saw them do it. And I said, hey, what are you doing? Because I'm just passing through. The supervisor's there, had her back turned or whatever. I didn't do it. Man, we really got a problem here. I saw you do it. You saw me saw you do it, and you didn't do it. Some people's dishonesty is like God. They speak creatively. They think that when they say it, that means it's supposed to be true, even though everybody knows it's not true. But they're like God, so God can say he's not dead, so open the tomb. Well, if God says he's alive, then you better open the tomb because his voice is creative, but ours is not. Just because I say something doesn't make it true. If it is true, that's fine. But if I'm saying it and it's not true, then it's called a lie. So we are not naturally honest. It's amazing when you look at little children, nobody has to teach them to be dishonest. There's no lessons like, okay, I want you to know how to tell a lie. No, they instantly already know that. Wee little. You ask them, did you do that? Now, some kids are so innocent, I'm really amazed at it. And this is what Jesus is talking about when he says, except you become as a little child. They're admitting some incriminating thing, and they're sitting there going, yes, I did. And I think that is so cute. They don't even know any better. But as soon as they figure out, if I say yes, I'm in trouble, oh, no, I didn't. So, we need to be honest. And only through cooperating with God can we do it. The Holy Ghost has a voice in your head, your conscience. Think about this. People talk about hearing from God. You hear from God all the time if you really realized it. Because if you're getting ready to do something and it's not pleasing to God, if you got the Holy Ghost and you're sensitive to it, the Lord's going to prompt you. I tell this story when I was trading Forex. It's a large market, $2.5 trillion a day. And I was wanting to make billions of dollars so I could bless the kingdom of God. Never mind that probably I would be blessed too. But I wasn't saying that part, to be honest. And the Lord just, he wasn't happy with the energy and the effort and all of that, just fuss over it. Because I already have a job. Now, if that was your job, and some people that is their job. I heard Morgan Stanley a few years ago trading Forex, and they made $1 billion in 1 year just in a trading platform. So, but the Lord wasn't happy with me doing that. And so he just spoke into my heart and said, I can do better than Forex. And I took it to mean what I was feeling all along, right? People would say, you're gambling. I'd say, no, I'm not gambling. I know the market. I know how to make a trade. I know what is going to be up and down. And if it gets too bad, I can pull out. Yeah, but where is all of that feeling and emotion and energy going all times of day and night when you're supposed to be pastoring a church and working for God? The Holy Ghost, the Lord's not mean. He's not harsh. He just simply said to me, I can do better than 4X. And I said, yes, sir. I quit. It's been so long now. It was 2008. And I left money in the trading platform. I'm probably going to get it out someday, but I just left it in there. I mean, I literally closed it down, and I don't even know the password to get in it. But guess what? God does better than 4X. I'm talking about being able to hear from God. I'm talking about having a conscience. When God wants to talk to you and you're getting ready to do something that's not pleasing to him, he can talk to you if you'll listen. But then there's such a thing as a conscience seared. If something, your fingertips get seared, then you can't really feel. If there's scar tissue, you can't feel. Nerves aren't working there. And your conscience needs to be sensitive to the Holy Ghost. God's not mean. He's not hard. But what I'm talking about here in closing is we need desperately to cooperate to be holy. Because holy is only God. You got to get it from God. It's right, it's true, it's just, it's pure, it's honest. And he said in this scripture in Philippians, think on these things. Whatsoever a man thinketh in his heart, so is he. So if you're thinking about being just, if you're thinking about being true, if you're thinking about being pure, if you're thinking about being honest, guess what? Dishonesty comes along and you say, no, I don't need that because I want to be honest. The cashier hands you your change and your money back too. I've had it happen to me before. Hand them two 20s and the change is $10.38 and they hand me my change in the two 20s too. And then when I hand it back to them and they're looking at me like, oh my goodness, I just about made a terrible mistake. And then they take a double take and look at me like, and you didn't take it. You were honest. Well, I'm honest because it pays to be honest. I don't want to go to bed at night and the Holy Ghost is talking to me. You get in a bragging fest talking about what you did and what you used to do and how, what you could do and say things that aren't true. I did that once on a job. Back in 1972, I was on the job and guys were talking about stuff they did and I started talking along. I got home in bed that night and I thought, oh, Lord, that wasn't true. That's so dumb. I couldn't sleep all night long. I couldn't wait to get to work. All I needed to do is get it straight. I wanted to tell them, you know what, guys? It wasn't true. It was a lie. I just got caught up in the moment. So I did. I mean, the Holy Ghost was dealing with me all night long. I was feeling terrible. I couldn't sleep. I got in my car and went to work. I got there and I collected the guys around and the supervisor was one. I said, I got to tell you guys, we were talking yesterday and all of that. You know what? It wasn't true. Guess what they did? Well, there's several guys. They got angry. They got upset. They got embarrassed. I can't believe you did that. I can't believe that you, you didn't need to tell us. We don't care. Why would you come back and tell us that? I said, because I couldn't sleep. I took it as an opportunity to testify. I couldn't sleep all night. The Holy Ghost was badgering me, to be honest. I feel so much better now. I'm glad I told you, and now you feel bad. I started making fun of them. They were embarrassed for me. They felt upset. Why would you come and tell us that? Because I can't sleep. The Holy Ghost just needs your cooperation. You say, oh, I'm too proud. I can't go back and tell the truth. Well, if you got the Holy Ghost, you can't sleep. And you learn a lesson, right? Somebody says they did something great, you just say, man, that's really great. You don't have to have me. We had one guy in school, everything you said, he did something better. If you caught a fish this big, he caught a fish that big. If you went this fast, he went faster. And he was just a little guy. It's like everybody would say, man, the guy is the biggest liar you ever see. It was like, people were ashamed of him because, and I'm saying, you don't have to do that. Just stick with the truth. You're not the biggest axe for the biggest tree. There's always going to be a bigger tree, a bigger axe. There's always going to be somebody better. There's going to be somebody taller. There's going to be somebody smarter. We don't have to be everything. We are who we are. God made us. But the most lovely and beautiful thing in the eyes of God is to be true, to be pure, to be honest. You can sleep at night if you're honest. You don't have to stand in judgment with fear and unbelief. No fear. Jesus, I'm so glad to get to see you. I've been longing to see you all my life. Thank you for washing away my sins. Thank you for saving my soul. It's a very scary situation because eternity is hanging in the balance. But if you're pure, I want to read my last scripture, 1 Peter chapter 1, verse 13. We're going to read down through this. I don't mind telling you what time I'm trying to get done, but I'm not making any promises because I don't want to be dishonest. Listen to these scriptures now. This is it. We're not going any further, but this scripture is amazing. Wherefore, gird up the loins of your mind, be sober, and hope to the end for the grace, that's power from God, for the grace it is to be brought unto you at the revelation of Jesus Christ. We're going all the way to the end. As obedient children, not fashioning yourselves according to the former lust in your ignorance, but as he which hath called you is holy, so be ye holy in all manner of conversation. That means behavior. Because it is written, be ye holy, for I am holy. And if you call on the Father, who without respect of persons judgeth according to every man's work, pass the time of your sojourning here. Listen to this now. I want you to focus on this last word. Pass the time of your sojourning here in fear. That means respect. Don't get sloppy in your serving God. Don't get sloppy in your living for God. Don't get sloppy here because everything's on the line. Pass the time in fear. For as much as you know that you were not redeemed with corruptible things as silver and gold. In other words, he didn't purchase your salvation with a payment. From your vain conversation received by the tradition from your fathers. But with the precious, everybody say precious. Let's stand together. With the precious blood of Christ, as of a lamb without blemish and without spot, who verily was foreordained before the foundation of the world, but was manifest in these last times for you. In other words, God is a spirit. He didn't need to have a body necessarily, but he took on a body so that he could interact with us. Who by him do believe in God, that raised him up from the dead, gave him glory, that your faith and your hope might be in God. Seeing ye have purified your soul in obeying the truth through the Spirit unto unfreighted love of the brethren, see that ye love one another with a pure heart fervently. I want to read that scripture again because listen to what he's saying. This whole Bible study that I gave tonight is right here in this scripture. I explained to you how to live holy, how to be pure, how to be honest, how to be right, how to be just. Seeing that you have purified your soul in obeying the truth through the Spirit unto unfreighted love of the brethren. In other words, now I have been holy, I have been pure, I have been just, I have been honest. He said, that's good. But I want you to use your relationship in God to love the brethren. See that you love one another with a pure heart fervently. Being born again, not of corrupted seed, but of incorruptible, by the word of God, which liveth and abideth forever. For all flesh is as grass, and the glory of man is as the flower of the grass. And the grass withers, and the flower thereof falleth away. But the word of the Lord endureth forever. And this is the word which by the gospel is preached unto you. That's a powerful scripture. In all of my honesty, in all of my pureness, in all of my cooperation with God to be what I'm supposed to be, I am now commanded to love you. Love one another. He said, be holy. The only way I can do it is by the Holy Ghost. I want us to ask God tonight to help us, because that's the only way. Ask. Ask the Savior to help you. That's how it works. Amen. Bite your tongue if words start coming out that aren't right. It's just the pride of life. It's just trying to be something we're not. The amazing thing is people are very perceptive, and most of the time they know where we are and who we are. The best thing to do is just be humble and say, you know what, I need your mercy, I need your love, I need your grace. Can't go wrong when you don't have anything to be afraid of. I'm inviting us down to talk to God as we sing some choruses and promise to cooperate. We need to cooperate.